Learning because life never stopped teaching. Good morning, everyone, and a very warm welcome to the Virtual International Conference on Global Research Trends in Biotechnology, Department of Biotechnology from St. Joseph's College of Engineering. Before we start, I request you all to follow a few instructions to ensure the smooth sailing of the event. Please do not unmute your microphones throughout the session and do not introduce yourselves in the chat box. Kindly post any questions you have in the chat box and they will be answered at the end. If you face any technical difficulties at any point, relay them in the chat box and we will look into it. I suggest you all to use your earphones for better quality. The feedback forms will be posted in the chat box sometime during the session, and I thank you in advance for your cooperation. We will now begin on an auspicious note with the Tamil Thai Valtar. I now welcome the HOD of our department, Dr. G. Sri Kumar, to address the participants.
Good morning, everybody. I take immense pleasure in inaugurating this session of Virtual International Conference on Global Research Trends in Biotechnology. It's a 4 days program, starts by 15th and ends by 18th of this month. It's organized by Department of Biotechnology, St. Joseph College of Engineering, YMR Chennai. A brief note about the college and the department I like to give. St. Joseph College of Engineering is one of the top colleges of India, and it has been ranked 160th position by National Institutional Ranking Framework, that is NIRF. And the college or institution is having 26 years of high reputation in academic society, and it has been accredited by NAAC with A plus grade. And this institution is affiliated to Anna University Chennai and having 10 UG programs and 5 PG programs, all are accredited by NBA accreditation. Right. Coming to the Department of Biotechnology, it has been started in the year 2002 and has both BTech and MTech biotechnology programs. And in order to maintain the quality of education, the Department of Biotechnology has retained their intake capacity with 60 students per year. And the department has also got a research center recognition under Anna University, where PhD programs and MS research programs also can be conducted. The department is having a state-of-the-art laboratory facility and with 1.1 crores of funding from government agencies. And the Department of Biotechnology is very consistent in going for 100% pass percentage every year. And it backs 12 university ranks on an average, and which is constitutes around 40% of the total ranks declared by Anna University. So far, the department, right from the inception, got 139 ranks. Out of that, 10 gold medals and 7 silver medals have been achieved. And out of the total students, 60% of them every year on an average goes for placement, and 40% of them going for higher studies both in India and abroad. Anything that is out of the sight, it becomes out of the mind. That is what people used to say. Education is not an exception in this case. We tend to forget things as the days go on and when we are not constantly in touch with it. The current COVID pandemic lockdown period makes us very inert and not being active mentally. Slowly, both the teachers and the staff members, I mean students, they tend to forget subject knowledge over a period of time. Keeping things in mind, the Department of Biotechnology of St. Joseph College of Engineering has designed this conference program with a motto of learning together even when we are apart. The entire world, when it is slowed down, we should rediscover ourselves. The skills and the knowledge available in the society is enormous and incredible. This kind of conferences brings them in a common platform and shares each other's with the knowledge. As a faculty, we should always keep learning. Learning is a verb, which is present continuous term tense. I should say always, the learning by its meaning also, it should be continuous and present. As a teachers, when you improve your knowledge, your voice and confidence will automatically get improved. And as a students, increase your knowledge so that the knowledge itself will increase you. The knowledge, when you see it is a power, learning should be a superpower. The conference is a best choice and chance for achieving it. For this conference, 529 participants have been registered so far. And out of this, I am happy to say that 163 faculty members are there and 43 research scholars and PG students, 45 numbers, and students, that is UG graduate students, they are 278. Totally, there are 37 poster and paper presentation as far as the competition is concerned. The participants are from heterogeneous background, and there are around 14 states in India the participants are from, and there are from 4 countries. Once again, the participants have come, that is to list them: China, Malaysia, UAE, Zambia, etc. So here, to abreast ourselves with the global research trends, we have invited the technical experts as the invited speakers, such as Dr. Mustafa Mohammed Essa, who is a keynote speaker, is an associate professor in Sultan Qaboos University, Sultanate of Oman, and Dr. Jovian George, Senior Research Fellow, நியூயார்க் பிளட் கலெக்ஷன் சென்டர் நியூயார்க் யூஎஸ்ஏ அண்ட் டாக்டர் சுகுணா பெருமாள் ப்ரொஃபஸர் இன் நேஷனல் யூனிவர்சிட்டி சவுத் கொரியா டாக்டர் நரேந்திர சேகர் சயின்டிஸ்ட் கிரீன் லைட் பயோ சயின்சஸ் இன்கார்பரேஷன் யூஎஸ்ஏ டாக்டர் நிர்மல் கே சம்பத்குமார் ரிசர்ச் அசோசியேட் கிங்ஸ் காலேஜ் லண்டன் ஆஃப் யூகே அண்ட் டாக்டர் வெங்கடேஷ் கோபிநாராயண் சயின்டிஸ்ட் லைஃப் மைண்ட் தெரப்பியூட்டிக்ஸ் இன்கார்பரேஷன் யூஎஸ்ஏ ஃபார் டெக்னிக்கல் லெக்சர் ஆர் டெக்னிக்கல் பேப்பர் காம்படிஷன் வி ஹவ் காட் எ பேனல் ஆஃப் ஜட்ஜஸ் வேர் டாக்டர் எஸ் பழனி இஸ் அ ப்ரொஃபஸர் ஆஃப் அருணை இன்ஜினியரிங் காலேஜ் டாக்டர் கே தமிழரசன் அசோசியேட் ப்ரொஃபஸர் எஸ்ஆர்எம் யூனிவர்சிட்டி அண்ட் டாக்டர் ஜீவிதா தனபால் ப்ராடக்ட் மேனேஜர் லேப்மெட் ஏசியா லிமிடெட் சென்னை அண்ட் வித் திஸ் இன்ட்ரோடக்டரி நோட் ஐ வாண்டட் டு வெல்கம் ஆல் ஆஃப் யூ ஆன் தி பிஹாஃப் ஆஃப் மேனேஜ்மெண்ட் அண்ட் டிபார்ட்மெண்ட் ஆஃப் பயோடெக்னாலஜி ஃபார் திஸ் ஆகஸ்ட் அகேஷன் ஓவர் டு ஸ்வாதிகா.
Thank you for your kind words, sir. We will now move on to releasing the conference proceedings. Before that, a conference proceeding is published a record of the conference. It typically contains the contributions made by various researchers at the conference and also contains the abstracts and reports of papers presented by the participants. Now, I again request the HOD, Dr. G. Sri Kumar, to unveil the proceedings of these conferences.
As a mark of inauguration of this virtual international conference of current trends of research in biotechnology, I take pleasure in releasing this conference proceedings. So you can see now it contains the technical lecture information from the invited speakers and research articles of competing papers and poster presentations and a felicitation messages from the management and other valuable information. This is going to be sent to you along with the certificate at the end of the program. At this moment, I wanted to wish everybody all the best, and I wanted to thank you also for organizing this particular event. I want to thank the organizing committee, biotechnology department staff members, and the management people, patrons of this program. That is Dr. Babu Manohar is a chairman, and Mr. Sashi Shekhar is a director, managing director, Madam Jessie Priya, and our principal Dr. Seshagiri Rao, and Dean Dr. Parvathavardhini Madam, etc. And I also thank the invited speakers for accepting our request, and I also thank 529 participants from various parts of the world to witness this particular program. Through this conference, we will keep upgrading our skills and knowledge in order to make our best version in your future. Thank you very much. Thank you.
This is a closer view of our conference proceedings. It will be available as a soft copy and will be given to you all. I'd like to take this time to thank our patrons, Dr. B. Babu Manohar, Mrs. S. Jessie Priya, Mr. B. Shashi Shekhar, Dr. Vadi Sheshagiri Rao, and Dr. B. Parvathavardhani for their support. And I'd finally like to thank our HOD, Dr. G. Sri Kumar, for releasing the proceedings. Now, without any further ado, let's get into today's session. I have the great pleasure of introducing Dr. Mustafa Mohammed Esa as the keynote speaker for this event. He is an associate professor at Nutrition College of Agricultural and Marine Sciences at Sultan Qaboos University, present in the Sultanate of Oman, and holds a visiting professor position in neuropharmacology at Macquarie University. He is the editor-in-chief for the International Journal of Nutrition, Pharmacology, and Neurological Diseases, published by Wolters Kluwer, USA. He is also the editor for the Frontiers in Neuroscience, Frontiers in Bioscience, and the associate editor for BMC Complementary and Alternative Medicine. He is an expert in the field of nutritional neuroscience and neuropharmacology and has published more than 145 papers, 54 book chapters, and 11 books. In 2015, he founded the Food and Brain Research Foundation to support research in nutritional neuroscience. Dr. Esa is a recipient of many awards from local and international bodies. In 2015, one of his books titled Food and Brain Health was awarded as the best book in the world by Gourmand Cookbook Awards for the 20th time. In 2015 and 2016, he received the National Research Award under the health sector from the Research Council of Oman. These are just a few of his accomplishments. He has over 15 years of research and teaching experience, and till now has received many research grants estimating over $1.45 million from local and international agencies for his work in neuropharmacology and nutritional neurosciences. Once again, it is an immense pleasure to have you with us today, sir. I request you to take over the session.
Good morning. Today I'm going to share, first of all, I have to thank Dr. Samu Disari. I came to know her through Dr. Professor Palani from Arun Engineering College, and I'm glad to right away accepted the invitation. Where I come from, that's why. And also they organized very well in very short duration. It's a really wonderful job. Even Dr. Samu Disari contacted me many times, and odd times also, because patrons and all these people work hard to bring this webinar in a successful way. So today I'm going to give general talk as well as some work, research work, what we do here and our collaborator lab in US and Australia. Specialist in nutritional neuroscience. We simply call, maybe you may not heard about that title. It is well-known title. It's everyone knows. And the only thing is, it's not well executed or well going to give the talk food for thought. First, I have to say I don't have any conflict of interest. That is my institute's responsibility to lab. I have to tell this. Question about the brain. Everybody knows that the brain is a most complex and sensitive physiological structure in the body, human body. You can see, for example, today morning and somebody and you can see your performance in the school or college, in the office, it will be little abnormal. Maybe some people come and ask you, can you give me this paper? You say, no, I will give later, or something like that. If some baby is crying, when you feed them, they stop crying. Otherwise, they yell here and there, they jump here and there, they're crawling this one, that one. So we can know that we clearly activity, the behavior, human behavior. But unfortunately, this field is highly neglected field. Even though people know that this is very important field. And then there are many several neurological diseases. And you simply say, if you have the healthy or balanced diet, you can develop and maintain the healthy central nervous system, either before birth or after birth. For many diseases by using diet. I give the example epilepsy, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, autism, even autism like ADHD and multiple sclerosis. Many, many neurologic and if you alter your dietary constituents, automatically it impact the outcome of the brain disorders. That's what we are going to discuss here. As I give you the example, like a baby's movement in the prison in United States of America, they checked, they did a big study on that, and they check with the criminals who were arrested, what they were taking before they do the crime. Carbohydrate and me, like, you know, too much food and alcohol and other things. Hello? So, indirectly, boosted by, like, you know, food items. Even you can say, if some people are tired, or you say, I want to have a cup of coffee, I want to have a cup of tea, or I want to have some snacks. That's what we are going to discuss. First, I'm going to give some idea about calorie restrictions or fasting. You know, any religion you follow, even Christian or Muslims, keep some food, and then they do some religious activities. But science proved that if you do the intermittent fasting regularly and do the calorie restrictions, your brain bioenergetic and then the link neuroplasticity. Neuroplasticity means the link between one neurons and another neurons will be improved, and the new neurons will be generated, and also resilience will be happening. The TNF-alpha, interleukin, these are the cytokines, inflammatory cytokines, they will be reduced, and even the insulin resistance and glucose, all these things in the brain will be reduced, balanced, and the good it says, if you have the proper regular fasting or calorie restriction, you can have the good brain function. So how our body works on the our body, you know, brain has hippocampus, where in the cognitive function, the memory and learning will be improved. How, when you have the less work for the brain. Percentage of sugar molecule what we take from the food. You know, brain is very small size, but it can able to use 25% of sugar. So what it does, it improves the neuronal plasticity. And as I told you, if you are having the fasting, and it improves the brain function in many ways. Links between one neurons and another neurons, and improves the neurogenesis and resilience. And if you have the regular intermittent dietary energy restriction, learning. So in detail, we are going to see everything in detail. First of all, we know that brain is only 2% of body weight, and it is a small organ. It receives 15% of cardiac output and 20% of the oxygen and 25% of the glucose utilization. So due to high usage of oxygen and high usage in end products, so automatically there will be some reactive oxygen species formation. Based on the location of neuronal death, the diseases of name of the diseases will be different. Area called striatum. If you have neuronal degeneration here, that means cell death, neurons death, that is the disease called Huntington disease. This area is called as hippocampus. If you at everything. This area is called substantia nigra. This is a disease called Parkinson's, and this is arterial occlusion is lead to stroke. So apoptosis or neuronal death that causes neurodegenerative diseases. So see the image, how we are looking at the age of 20 and then at the age of 70, how the system or body like that. So every year or every a decade, automatically our face resemblance will be different. So this is due to the structural degeneration and we proposed a mechanism. I want to give you details about every disease and then I will tell you what are the food's benefits for the each disease. So there are, the disease called Alzheimer. What is Alzheimer? This is the people start forgetting things. If you recall in our family, somebody is getting old after 60, after 65. What we will do, they start forgetting the things. Simply say, we will leave them the name, start forgetting the street, start forgetting the car key, all these things. Do you know how it happens? Usually, there's two proteins involved. One is amyloid beta protein, another is tau protein. The amyloid beta of us, even everyone produces this amyloid beta protein and it can be cleared by a normal mechanism. But under some conditions, this will not be cleared and it will be linked between one neurons and another neurons will be affected and then signaling will be affected in the brain. Then you start losing your neurons. Simultaneously, this protein, another important protein for Alzheimer's disease, tau protein. Or we can say Alzheimer's disease. So if you are doing the intermittent fasting, how it is beneficial for Alzheimer's disease? See this blue area, the microglial activation will be red. Is the bunch of grapes aggregation, avoid amyloid beta peptide aggregation will be avoided and apoptosis, the cell death of neurons will be. These are the things will happen. There will be increased cell death and microglial activation and then amyloid beta aggregation and neurofibrillary tangles. Next time, it happens of the people over 85, over 65, and you can see here clearly the normal neurons, they deliver the dopamine. But if it is Parkinson's disease, at that time the neuronal release of dopamine will be less and then it causes the movement disorder. So if these are the things, accumulation of dopamine, all these things will be affected. Same cell death will be increased free radical generation. But if you have intermittent fasting, it improves the antioxidant enzymes, neurotrophin, so indirectly it says if you have to give some pause for your body to die, use the food properly. So this is the summary for this one. If you have the intermittent motor function is increased and the mitochondrial function will be increased and the protein aggregation will be decreased. Same thing in Alzheimer. So what, how the intermittent fasting help? It helps neuronal potencies. And also it reduces toxicity, which is called excitotoxicity. You know, every message is sent from one neuron to another neuron, like WhatsApp, like what we are doing now, WhatsApp, we are using just like that. You can contact any if you see left side, they are the brain boosters, which are the diets which can help the brain function properly. And this the right side shows the brain drainers. I'm sure most of the people love to have this. See the brain drainers first, then we will go for the toxic chemicals and metals. There are many toxic chemicals available naturally as well. Arsenic, thallium, lead, and aluminium. So what are the sources of arsenic? You know, groundwater is a high sources for arsenic and tobacco and industrial waste. Having less quantity. So this is a mechanism proposed by the arsenic neurotoxicity. What it does? Arsenic disturb the neurotransmitter and your memory and learning. Tau protein as well as amyloid, the bunch of grapes, and leads to neurodegeneration. And also there is high amount of free radical generation, leads to neuronal death. And also they leads to the cytoskeletal gene closer to arsenic, then these are the things will happen to your body. Next, we are going to see about the thallium. It is says that it is even the small quantity, it is highly toxic. Yeah, they are having the sources of thallium. So what happened when you have the high amount of thallium in your body? So see, it is indirectly linked with the mitochondria and improve the in your antioxidant defense system. Next one, we are going to see about the lead. It's mainly available in the paint, it's drinking water or contaminated soil. And nowadays, because to maintain the some taste or something like that, they are adding this lead. It's highly dangerous. So what happens when you have the lead neurotoxicity? So you see here, it enters the blood-brain barrier and it and the neural transmission convey message from one person, one cell to another cell will be affected, and then your the regulation done by the calcium will be affected, and then you have the, like, you know, automatically you will have the neuronal death. The another important compound we use regularly, especially in India, we cook in aluminium food, aluminium containers, and then even now we store the food, or if you buy the food, and especially if you keep the hot cooked food in the aluminium, it causes the, it automatically accumulates in your food and leads to the aluminium toxicity. As a barrier called blood-brain barrier, what it does? It simply checks any compound cross the blood-brain barrier. That means it crosses or reaches the brain. If it into the parliament, So here, aluminum, it can easily cross the blood-brain barrier because of its toxic nature. And you see here, it is easily cross the blood-brain barrier. And then it could cause abnormal cytoskeleton protein rearrangement and conformational change happens. All these things lead to aluminum can easily cause the neuronal degeneration. Some studies they are using, even ourselves, we are using this aluminum chloride as a this image clearly shows how it can aluminum can cause the neurotoxic actions. See, this is a bunch of grapes, amyloid beta protein. I told you, the, from monomer to polymer it causes. Then it leads to the death. Clearance will be affected and there will be phagocytosis will be affected. You know what is phagocytosis? We usually clear our body items, but this here it will not let clear. So again, we are continuing the blood. Heavy metals. Now we are going to see the regular use. Coffee. You know, coffee is helpful for the people who feel sleepy. If you have only 50 to 20, 200 milligram. And then your perform ability is be increased. But later, you will have insomnia. That means sleepiness. Sleeping is affected. And then nervousness, and then irritability, and then restlessness. If you happen, it's all, it leads to the cardiac arrhythmia. So if you have the normal 3 to 5 cups per day, what happens? It increases the wakefulness, alleviate fatigue, and then concentration. And then less sleep. If you are, for example, people working in the night shift, they have the coffee, or people work continuously, they can have the coffee, then improve their work capacity. And then errors will be reduced. And there are some recent caffeine will improve the even beneficial for diabetic. So if you take too much coffee, more than 5 cups, and then you, as I told you, there will be high amount of anxiety. Anxiety means and then you will keep losing your body water. That's called diuresis. So this is an image. It was, even though it is old one, 1995, conducted by the NASA. So they give the coffee to the spider. It's marijuana. See the confusion. This is another drug. See the caffeine. At least these three, you can see at least try. The spider is trying to fill the round side. Here, then 3 to 5 cups per day of coffee. Then another one is alcohol. Alcohol, everybody knows that it causes a tissue damage, skin damage, etc. But it's mainly causes a brain damage. VIP pass to cross the blood-brain barrier, just like that. That's why you can see the people who drinks alcohol, they have the impaired judgment, they have amnesia, they have anxiety, and then fear, and then disturbed balance. So I can do anything. But because of too much confidence, they lose their judgment. It leads to the fatal combination. So we recently proposed, if somebody has, you know, the people who is infected with any disease, eating. Because of that, there is a gut leakage happens, gut microbiome changes, and leakage happens, leads to the neuronal degeneration. This was proposed by us last year. you know, heart damage, everybody knows, and sugar imbalance, we can say pancreas will be malfunction. And then if you have low folic acid, you have the embryo deformation, low calcium, bone, alcohol, liver. It's brain inefficiency, memory loss. So now we are going to the real part. What is power of nutrient? What is nutrient? Nutrient is the constituents present in the food. We can say two types of nutrient. Protein, lipids, and everything. Micronutrient, water, or even water you can consider in both ways. We can simply say minerals and vitamins. What they do? They form religion. You can thank God, or you can, if you not believe in religion, you can thank the nature. Our body has a transmission system like a WhatsApp or whatever social media network we are using. It is already available in our so you are walking to the door. When you see the eye sees a door, it is closed. Automatically the eye send the message to the brain. The brain send the message to the hand. This all happens in nano or microseconds. How it happens? You know, usually what we do when we attend the class as students, you simply say, teacher is here, can you come? Then all the students will come. That message happened by WhatsApp now, but our body has this kind of messaging system from the day one. So I all the time says we have the WhatsApp in our body, for example, to better understand it. Helps to produce this neurotransmitter, the messaging system. And also there is a link called synapse. What is synapse? Combination between the one, the connection point between the one neuron, regularly, that will be done by nutrients. So now we are going to see one by one, like, you know, what is carbohydrate can do, what is protein can do, what is fats can do, what then one by one. You know, as I told you, our body utilizes 20 to 30. It is brain, that's why brain is controlling the appetite, the motivation and reward processing. So this is the way our body works on the glucose level. First, this POMC, pro-apio. Related peptide, what they do, they present the hypothalamus, they sense whether you have a central or peripheral glucose level, how high or low. When they sense, they send the message to the next one. Hey, the glucose through the blood-brain barrier, which will be done by the glucose transporter 1. Then the glucose will be distributed to the other coupled neuronal cells or brain cells. If you have any issues in that, then automatically we have the issues in the brain and leads to the disorders. So the glucose hypermetabolism is reported in the and we know that the obesity and type 2 diabetes are a link. I all the time say to my students, there are three close friends. If one comes, bring others too. Like obesity, type 2 diabetes, as well as the with Alzheimer's disease progression and also your memory impairment. And then how it happened, the insulin resistance, whether you have the diabetic or not, it impacts the brain structure and function. And there is a significant protein called metalloprotease. This is called insulin degrading enzyme, which is responsible for the amyloid beta protein degradation. That is the bunch of grapes I told you, know. So in the insulin can involve indirectly leads to the production of amyloid beta. So there are similar mechanisms available in the for diabetes and Alzheimer's and Parkinson. What happens in diabetes? Enzyme called dipeptidyl peptidase 4. We simply say DPB4. What it does? It leads to the insulin brain loss. And what happened? Because of this insulin loss in brain, we lose the GLP, glucagon like. Of neurons and leads to the Alzheimer's and Parkinson's. So the same mechanism happens whether you have the diabetic or not. So now people are saying that Alzheimer's or Parkinson can call as type 3 diabetes. And if you have the high energy diet, what happened to your memory? Excessive intake, so lead to the inflammatory process will be higher and your cellular adaptive response will be lower. Damage in your brain by macronutrients, then you'll have the cognitive dysfunction. You know that if you see the human brain or you can see the animal brains is full of fats, made up of fats. They really needed to help the neurotransmitter signaling. And study and suicidal behaviors. You know, yesterday we heard about one of the very famous Indian actor who did by who died by the suicide, and he was in depression. And then studies says that the and myelin sheath in turns neuronal influences the neuronal function. So what the fatty acid can do in the body? They can improve your attention, they can improve your reasoning skills. There is a homeostasis mechanism between so glucose and lipids. What they do in the right side, if you see here, left side, you can see homeostasis of lipid and protein, lipid and glucose. But if you have wrong things, then automatically the clearance will not be happening and leads to the neurodegeneration, causes the Alzheimer's disease. Three, they take the supplements. I suggest you to not to take the supplements. Why? Because if you have enough amount of fish, or if you take walnuts or any nuts, they have the required amount of omega-3 per six. Omega-6 is available in oils and dressing and pork and beef and processed food, and it is very bad for your brain because it what it does, it becomes found in the fish and seafood and the nuts and legumes and green leafy plants and olive oils. What it does, it causes the brain cell become more fluid and helps for the brain. The optimal ratio for this omega-3 and omega-6 is 1:1. If you have more than 5:1 irrespective of in favor of omega-6, you have the impairment. Average American omega 3. But you know, nowadays, in India, especially in Chennai, how many McDonald's, how many KFCs, how many junk foods? Originally, we, because of a regular, our good diet, like spices. Now, it has become a regular, it has become a fashion, it become regular habit to go and eat outside food, especially junk food. Because of that, even though Asians are setting lowest ratios for this, balance between omega 3 and omega 6, that is optimal ratio is 1:1. So omega 3 helps for the cognition, depression, reduce the depression, all these things. If you have the low level, the kids, even some studies say that autism. So next one, we finish the fats and glucose. Now we are going to do the proteins. You know, there are many neurotransmitters produced by the amino acids, common improves your sleep and pain tolerance and reduce food cravings. Next one is tyrosine. Tyrosine is produced for the dopamine and norepinephrine. It helps for your mental which is responsible for acetylcholine, which is improve the memory and general mental ability. So how our food sources help for the production of neurotransmitter? These are the examples, like, you know, pomace. They produce, tyrosine produces a neurotransmitter. They increase the alertness and energy. And then another important amino acid is tryptophan, which is a sleep hormone. You know, how can you find out how your body has a proper sleep hormone production? What do? You close your doors, everything close, set up the room with full dark. You feel sleepy automatically. He thinks, hey, this is the time to sleep. So it enables the production of, it send the message to the brain. Brain send the message to the pineal gland. Pineal gland produces the melatonin, which maintains our sleep-wake cycle. How can salmon fish, main thing is dairy product, highly rich in the tryptophan, even potatoes, bananas. So next we are going to see the vitamins. Vitamin A is about the neural differentiation, what kind of cells going to produce, and the neurite outgrowth, and also axonal elongation. What are the food sources? We can get it from the carrot, potato, sweet potato, and turkey, beef, and important, you know, if you see the, if 100 people are there, any place, if you check, out of 100, 75 people will have the vitamin D deficiency or insufficiency, or they are in the border level. Why? Because we are not utilizing proper sunlight. And vitamin D has to play a major role in the cell signaling, cell differentiation, cell proliferation and growth factor signaling, and then many, even they regulate the gene expression. Your immune regulation will be very well, and then the amyloid beta protein clearance will be very well, and protein aggregation will be stopped. Neuronal transmission happens very well. Mitochondrial function happens very well. And imbalance or insufficiency in vitamin D all happens in other way around, then you lead to the diseases called Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, dementia, neurocognitive. And now there are many studies people who has the vitamin D high level, they are having the less symptomatic than the people who have the low vitamin D for COVID-19. So next one is vitamin K. Really needed for the cognitive function, because they can able to produce a protein called VKDP, vitamin K dependent protein, and helps for the synthesis of sphingolipids, that's called phospholipids in the brain. They myelination, first especially the insulation purpose for brain drops. And then B complex vitamin. Even though all the B complex vitamins are involved in the mitochondrial energy production, but they really need and then vitamin B12, it's highly needed for cell growth and replication as well as the brain health. If you have the low vitamin B12, automatically you will link with the cognitive decline. And the another of imbalance in your regular physiological functions, that will be protected by the pantothenic acid. It's anti-stress vitamin. So next we are going to see the minerals. We saw about the so example, we are here, we can see iron, calcium, selenium, zinc, copper, manganese, etc. What are the sources for iron? Dates, liver, egg, and then salmon fish and all these things. Homeostasis is normal frying function and neurotransmitter synthesis and insulation purpose synthesis and then bioenergetics. But if you have the imbalance, all become opposite way. Your myelin synthesis will be impaired. To the neurotoxicity or neurodegeneracy. So iron imbalance happens in Alzheimer's and Parkinson's. I know it looks like a very big image. Simple understanding is it reduces amyloid beta protein and tau protein and leads to Alzheimer's disease. The clearance will be affected. So you have the bunch of amyloid beta protein like grape punch, then automatically leads to the Alzheimer disease. It is found in the beef, turkey, chicken, fish, etc. If you have the selenium normal, then your calcium glutamate influx will be normal. Your neuronal cell But if it is other way around, if you have the same deficiency, then your glial activation will be higher. Glial cell activation will be higher, and then NF kappa B will be higher. Then you will be apoptosis for neurons, and you will get the seizures. Foods which have the high amount of zinc. Now zinc is highly linked with the people say it is highly linked with autism, the neurodevelopmental disorders. So if you have the zinc deficiency or amount of amyloid beta deposition, then it will be lead to the Alzheimer's disease formation. Next, we are going to see about the copper. It is present in the liver, spirulina, nuts, seeds, small amount. What happened? The copper will normal copper level plays major role for neuroprotection and neurodegeneration because of its chelating function. That means less copper, automatically you will have the neurodegeneration. The important mineral is calcium, which is present in the milk, cheese, and then green leafy vegetables, and these are the examples. because for easy understanding, it helps to the synaptic plasticity and it helps to the regular transcription or protein synthesis. But if we have problem in this overload, calcium overload, see, the Alzheimer's and Parkinson, ALS, Huntington disease, all these things happen. Because calcium is highly, highly linked with the brain dysfunction if you are having overload or less level. So next one is D. And manganese is highly plays major role in the protein misfolding. It works in the neuroprotective pathway. What happened? And the neuroprotective pathway means reduced apoptosis cell death because it binds with the alpha synuclein and there is no misfolding happens, protein misfolding happens, then it will be increased apoptosis or neuronal death. So these are the general introduction how our nutrients play what are the works we are doing in the in this area. We simply say it's nutritional neuroscience. So many examples like, you know, Mediterranean diet, walnuts, pomegranate, apple, these are the examples. But walnut, the whole walnut, how it looks? Looks like brine. And then half edible walnut, how it looks? It looks like brine. Because it has high amount of omega-3 fatty acids and melatonin, vitamin E and other phytochemicals. This is a process in which amyloid beta plaques will be forming and leads to the dementia. And then our products, like especially walnut diets, fights in many ways and improves motor coordination, spatial behavior in mouse model for Alzheimer. It's a transcription, transgenic mice. And we also produced, it works on the pomegranate. Pomegranate is beneficial for Parkinson's disease. And then like, you know, this is TNF-alpha and then iNOS. All these are highly play major role in the synaptic plasticity and long-term memory in the brain. You see, first is for 15 months, it improves. You can see the same trend in all other groups, all other parameters. So we published many papers in this, and then we published in a big journal. What happened? It stops the bunch formation, and it improves cognition, and it reduces the inflammation, and reduces the tau phosphorylation, and offers antioxidant activity. So because of that, already when you introduced, you said I have received 2 national research awards. This paper is one of that one. So how, what happened when you have the, when oxidative stress, all these things in the neurodegenerative, the pomegranate work in eye either ways, either here or here, and stop the neurodegeneration. And then once again, I'm recalling this image we discussed before, diabetic, APP4 stops the insulin. There is some compounds which are DPP4 inhibitors, especially exenatide, which can stop the insulin loss in the brain. So now we are working, proposing that if you have the compound from pomegranate, so insulin loss. So if you see here, the whole pomegranate cannot enter the blood-brain barrier. But if you have the individual compound, it processes the gut microflora and crosses the blood. things about the Parkinson's disease. Many environmental factors, genetic exposure, life exposure, especially head injury, they causes the Parkinson's disease, including the dietary factors. So we have worked in many components, walnuts, pomegranate. See here, this image shows the normal level and walnut treated, and this is diseased mice. See how walnut improved the diseased mice. And we have published in the papers in the very good journals. Another genetic disorder, neurodegenerative disease condition, in that there will be accumulation of Huntington protein and mitochondrial dysfunction and lipid concentration higher level. All this leads to Huntington disease. What happened? We proved that there are many edible items. They can improve the benefits. They can offer the beneficial function for Huntington disease. So we worked on the dates and then pomegranate. So next one, the doesn't have the disease, and their brain activity. See how it looks. When they have the disease, how the brain activity. So we worked on the gallic acid and ellagic acid, and this is one of my PhD students going to submit. Gallic acid, it improves the anxiety, fear-like function. See, the control mice doesn't have the, now the fear, the level is normal, and then the SAM, diseased mice, is very high. When you eat, same thing we see in the sodium-dependent dopamine transmitter in genetic. We did the gene expression, the same thing we occurred. See, the diseased mice have the low DAT1, and gallic acid and ellagic acid shows role, how they alters the behavior, they alters the biochemical pathways, they alters the genetic indices. So these are the papers we published recently on the ADHD. So to recall, Parkinson's disease and head injury and Huntington disease and ADHD. So how can you maximize the brain power through diet? First of all, don't skip your breakfast. Eat healthy breakfast. Consume and then decrease omega-3 ratio, and reduce the sodium, increase the potassium. Take a multivitamin if needed. Don't take unless until if you are sick. To conclude, as I told you, the food can act as a mood promoters, and then they can help for the proper functioning of brain, and they can improve the mental abilities, things you must have the proper nutrition or diet. If you maintain the proper diet, your main brain function will be very well. So if you have the improper nutrition, automatically you are prone to the automatically, everybody knows it can be affected by diet. So consume a healthy, regular, adequate diet, you will improve your mental health. So this is our group. I'm the principal investigator, my collaborators, my students. I have the collaboration from everywhere in the world. We have in USA, and NIH National Institute of Health, and Macquarie University Australia, and Seton Hall University, and Mysore, and then Canada, and Harvard, and Dr. Manivas. And quite all these people. And then I have to thank the funding agency, the Research Council Oman, and then grants from the Sultan Qaboos City Oman, Qaboos University Oman. Beyond the studies, we do the awareness. We conduct every like, you know, it's a color for the Alzheimer's. So every year we conduct, and also we have a foundation called Food and Brain Research Foundation, which are registered in India and US to support the people who is having the real international symposium. And since 2013, this will be the seventh year in November 2020. And these are our my books in this area. And then you see, we have many books. Award and the best book in the world. This is a recent book. This is a recent book published last month on the autism and how food can be beneficial. And also, I wrote some other authored books. Nutritional assessment. There is a new book coming next month by the Springer. It's a preclinical toxicology. And also, I'm an editor-in-chief for the International Journal of Nutrition, Pharmacology, and Neurological Diseases. It indexes in Scopus and PubMed is in the So most welcome to submit article in any field. And I'm also editor for Frontiers in Biosciences. My area is nutrition, aging and neurodegeneration in the impact factor is 2.9. Please feel free to submit. And also I'm an editor for series of 40 books on nutritional neuroscience. If you have any idea to edit a book or write a book, you are most welcome to contact me. It's going to start from summer 2020. If you are a good in December 2020, you can send me the your recipe, and then I'm glad to publish that one. And then, so what color you had today? Thank you so much.
So thank you for a very informative session. The brain is considered to be the most important organ, and each and every one of us would like, you know, we learned something about how to change our life and lifestyle, especially with the coffee and all. Most of us do drink it. So it is very useful for us. Now we will go on to the Q&A session. Some of the participants have some questions. So I'd like to call upon our convener, Mrs. K. Preeti ma'am, to come on and conduct the Q&A session now.
Thank you, Swatika. Sir, let me read out the questions for you. First question.
Okay, so I will go by one by first question. I can see that why is natural sugars like it is said by nat- why is that the natural sugars in- you know, we have a simple mechanism. You know, our body is as receptors for the natural sugars. But if you are preparing addictive, they, even though they bind like a pen, you have the natural sugars, our body has the like, you know, acceptance rate for the natural sugars. Simple question. If some newcomer come to your house, will you allow? You will not open the door without asking questions. But if it is natural sugars are already, like, you know, how can we say, already they have the pass to enter. That's a answer for my, answer for your question. Second one, one student, I'm not a scientist in COVID. She asked, is it work for COVID? I don't know. Maybe, but the incidence will be lower if you have the spices and pulses and even turmeric. And I told you, and then next question, there is ajinomoto. So one question asked by Vijaya, it starts, how about ajino, we say yes, like, you know, MSG, monosodium glutamate. It's highly improve. It produces the excitotoxicity in the brain and alters the calcium signaling in the brain. That's why it's a neurotoxin as well as a carcinogen. And another person asked about the question. Usually, in order to inactivate the natural enzymes present in the food, blanching is done on industrial level. For example, if you see olden days, our rice has the brown color rice. Now, can you see, we will not touch the brown rice. I know I can see people from Kerala, any part of the world, they love to eat the white one. Why? Because the appearance. What the company do, the business people, initially they give with the brown rice. Then they think they want to compete with the other people. They remove there. Now they are going for the, what we can say, they are going the enrichment and fortification to add the things. So whatever you are adding indirectly by industrial way, our body has the acceptance. Omega 3 helps for myelination. There are a lot of studies going on omega 3. And it, as I told you, it helps for the attention and memory and all these things. So it can be. Another person asked about hair fall. I really don't know what is hair fall. Link with the brain. Very seriously, I'm not working in that area. Amla, henna, that can be helpful for the hair growth. I don't know really. I'm not working in that field. So, sorry about that. Depression, simple thing is, first of all, the people needs support from the family. You have to be with them. People is depressed, they will be binge eating or they will not eat much. So we have to watch them. And you can have the milk which has a serotonin. Because serotonin reuptake inhibitor. So instead of going for medicines, because they get the resistance very soon, you can go for the natural foods which can have high in the tryptophan. It can reduce the depression, affect the brain function. If you ask me, I were you, I will not cut any diet, any nutrient in my food. I will watch the amount of intake. Wherever the diet has high amount of carbohydrates. Why? Because that is a universal currency for our body, which can produce us ATP very well. That's why. So, if you are one, don't cut anything. Adequate diet and balanced diet and less amount, that will be helpful for the brain function. For example, if you go for buffet, eat too much amount of food, then you feel sleepy affected if you take high amount of diet. And there is another person asked about, Priyanka asked about cooking in aluminium vessels affects food we eat. There are some possibilities, but used in olden days by our grandparents is different. Now the aluminium is processed one different way. So there may be a chance. But if you are buying any food which is hot and packed in the aluminium foil or accumulation of aluminium in the food, then they can impact your brain function. And the next question asked by the steroids are necessary compounds in I'm not a physician. I cannot talk about steroids, medicine and all. But you can go for natural items which can reduce the depression. Main thing all the time is the caretaker's responsibility. High prone to depression. Why? Because they are busy with the kids, family, and then personal work and all these things. So you need to be there, support. Even yesterday, you see that Mr. Sushant Singh, because of depression, there will be a lot of suicidal activities. So you have to monitor your family. Somebody, you can see the difference. Some people all the time talks, too much talking or less talking, or too much eating or less eating. You can see to follow the doctor's advice as well as reduces the, improve the balanced diet. Help them to take the good diet. That's the way you can do. And then there is another question asked. No, I am not a cancer biologist, but I know some studies. If you take more than 6 cloves of garlic or more high amount of ginger, they usually less amount of garlic and ginger they offer the protects. Carcinogens, but the diet which has the N-diethyl nitrosoamine (NDEA) they can cause the cancer. And then another host asked, can insomnia can be regulated by regular diet? How? If you want to sleep, first you plan the diet like this. And the way when you get up, have some milk, and then give the break, go for breakfast. And then give the break 2 hours and snack. Then you go for 7:30, go for dinner. Before bed, and then take small amount of milk. If possible, do some physical activity 30 to 45 minutes. Then reduce it. Because, and especially when you have the mobile phone in your bedroom, inside your bedroom, forget about it. You will be end up with insomnia. So if you follow all these things, your insomnia will be cured. It's called monosodium glutamate. Yes, it improves. It enables excitotoxicity. Signaling. Your message on WhatsApp in your brain will be affected. And then when you take in a small quantity, initial days, they improve, but later you become resistant and you become addict, and then you will end up with more problems. And another person calls, reduced by particular foods. Does ingestion of heavy metal play in the role in this? Yes. Many foods, already I told you, healthy items, olives, even you can have one cup of wine. If you are not drinking curcumin from turmeric, all this will help to reduce the amyloid beta aggregation. And then heavy metals worsen the amyloid beta aggregation. So these are the questions.
Thank you, sir. Thanks for your great explanation to the questions raised by our participant. Now I hand over the session to Ms. Vartika to give us a vote of thanks.
Thank you, ma'am. And also thank you, sir. I'd like to thank you again, sir, for taking the time to join us and imparting us on your knowledge on the various roles on food particles that have micro and macronutrients present in food have on our brain and how to improve the brain's function. I'd also like to take this time to thank our patrons, our HOD, Dr. G. Srikumar, convener, Dr. M. Chamundeshwari, and co-convener, Ms. K. Preeti, for giving us the support and making this event possible. And finally, I thank all the participants for your cooperation and your patience throughout the event. Before we wind up, I'd like to remind everyone that today is the last day for the abstract submission for both the oral and poster presentation. And the attendance will be taken via the feedback form that's there in the chat box right now. And it will be turned on for 30 minutes. Please fill it in as soon as possible. We appreciate you for being here. Stay safe, and I hope to see you all again in the next session this afternoon.